Members, we've formed the quorum at the appointed time. Item 1, confirmation of minutes. Minutes of the meeting held on the 9th of January has been circulated to members. The Secretariat has not received any proposed amendments. Can we confirm the minutes? Yes. Item 2, information papers issued since last meeting. There are 2 in total. Dr. N. Zhang, concerning food. Dr. Zhang? Item 2, 2 letters related to your good self. If there is no question, let's move on to item 3, date of next meeting and items for discussion. The Secretariat has issued the list of outstanding items for discussion, the list of follow-up action. The next meeting will be held on the 10th of April, 2:30 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. Proposed items for discussion, 3 in total. Implementation of the Convention on the Conservation of Antarctica Marine Living Resources in Hong Kong. New allocation arrangement for public niches, including extended boat niches and computer balloting. They have to come back to report to us. Third, proposed by the Vice Chairman, issues relating to the operation of the Liquor Licensing Board. So we will set the meeting at that day for 2 hours. All right. Based on earlier discussions here at the meeting, the panel will hold a special meeting for open hearing on the 30th of April at 9 a.m. And we will invite members of the public to discuss the implementation situation of the private calling barrier ordinance, particularly in relation to policy initiatives related to law, to land premium and traffic impact assessment of pre-cutoff columbarium. We might have to extend the meeting time depending on the number of deputations turning up. We will notify you later. We will put the matter up on our website. We will send letters to the 18 district councils. If members don't have any views on this, let's move on to item 4. And there are going to be 3 projects to be discussed. And if members have a pecuniary interest of conflict of interest in relation to these matters, please declare the same. I'm not going to read out the entire paragraph. All right, item 4. Provision of columbarium at Cape Collinson Road in Taiwan. So can we now invite the administration team to join us? We've invited all members of the council to take part in this item. Undersecretary, can you walk us through the paper briefly? And members, since this is a project, I would like to seek your advice towards the end whether you are going to support this project or not. Thank you. This is about provision of a columbarium at Cape Collinson Road in Taiwan. Right now, every year we see that there is quite a number of deaths, and 90% will opt for cremation. And the ashes have to be interred. So that's why we need to provide for more columbaria. Now, in 2011, we announced this policy that the 18 districts should help take up responsibility for providing columbarium, and the government has identified a total of 24 potential sites, and for this Cape Collinson Road site is one of the 24 sites. Right next to it is the Chinese permanent cemetery. There it's a 5-story columbarium block, and if everything goes smoothly, 25,000 niches can be provided. We will also improve the facilities. There will be escalators, staircases, and there will be connections to the nearby roads. We will also undertake road widening works at certain roads to improve the transport network. We have consulted the Eastern District Council and the relevant working groups or committees under the DC. They've supported the proposal, and the TIA in 2012, 14, and 17, remember, people have given views on that. And the TIA has expressed concern on additional traffic volume. So we hope that we can apply for funding from the PWSC and FC, and if everything goes smoothly, the works can commence in the fourth quarter of 2018 for completion by the first quarter of 2022. So there are altogether five members, including myself, six altogether, who would like to raise a question. The item will take us to 3:15 p.m. I'll give you 4 minutes each, including answers and questions. So I cannot guarantee that other members who walk in later will be given another will be given 4 minutes. Tanya Chan, Chen Han Pan, Raymond Chan, etc., and myself. Any other member wishing to speak? Okay. First, Tanya Chan. Thank you, Chairman. Maybe I should set my stance first. We have district councillors who are serving on Eastern District Council. Our stance is very clear. Pending the improvement of transport network and greening works, we will not agree to submit the proposal to the PWSC. I would like to find out from the government further what are our concerns first. First, this is an innovative design. And I would like to find out about the connection for pedestrians. There will be a new escalator, and that will connect the site to San Ha Street. Is it a one-way arrangement? There will be an escalator. Does it mean that it will go up? And if you get down, you have to go through the staircase. Secondly, for Taiwan residents, if you read news reports, there are already four cemeteries, the cemeteries for the Buddhism believers, Catholics, and so on. There are four major cemeteries, and if we are going to add an additional 25,000 niches, that would pose a heavy burden to them.
Okay, sir.
For the great sweeping season, all the roundabouts are clogged. So how would the transport department address this? And how much capacity do you expect this pedestrian escalator to handle? And how would it handle the minibus queues? And the pedestrians are quite likely using this escalator that we need to pass through Wan Chai Estate if we take the MTR. So would the passageways inside the shopping mall can handle such a huge pedestrian flow? We're expecting there are other scenarios. I hope the government can answer that. And for the 25,000 niches, would you in a would it be a double a niche for to orient and so on? And can you give us a breakdown? And the secretary or the so are the traffic issues and the PAS. So the escalator is about 1 meter wide. But next to the escalator, we have the stairway. So looking at the capacity for every hour, so we have 2,400 people. So there'll be about 5,000 in people in total every hour. According to TIA, we've worked calculated there's sufficient to handle the flow. As for the cemeteries nearby, consultation with the Eastern District Council, besides on the columbarium proposed, as well as on the escalators, and well on Cape Collinson Road, we had to widen it, and for grape sweeping season, and for San Ha Street, we will have a closed one carriageway to let the grave sweepers to queue. Furthermore, the EDC has told us that for Lin Cheng Road and Collinson Road, the corner, that we will have create two laybys. And for the Wan Chai Estate for the westward, They have offered us comments to whether we can set back a little, whether so that the bus can park, that do not obstruct the carriageway. So all these associated road works have been actively being taken up by different departments. So when consulting the EDC, they supported our proposed measures. Chairman, oh, not take up others colleagues' team. Now that what you under PAS said was not mentioned in the document, I hope that the administration can supplement this. And so my position is that we are objecting to the time to this project for the time being. So there's nothing to tell Tenyan Chen on the greening. We take the greening seriously. Besides, there will be a greening on the rooftop. In the surroundings, there will be a lot of vegetation. Well, due to time constraint, before we submit to PWSC, we'll supply additional information for members' reference. So now we have another member coming in. Okay, I'll draw the line there. Mr. Tommy Chang, so I need to draw the line, so I would not be able to allocate 4 minutes from afterwards. Mr. Kuo Wei-kyung, so I'm also a member of the EDC, so we've discussed that at the EDC. I remember at the FTU had objected in converting a private go-down into columbariums on the Chang waterfront. Some community had mistaken that we object to all the niches. We think the Kaiyup Street is not suitable. As for the public niches, is under all district responsibility. So the Eastern District chip in first, because in that area we have already niches in place and in the process. We're asking to provide supporting facilities. For example, at listed in document, the pedestrian escalators and passageways and road widening works. So considering all these factors, we offered our support. The community has a keen demand for niches. I would like to ask firstly, and for the Lynching Road and Collinson Road lay-by, and for the widening of the Cape Collinson Road for the setback of the bus stations, and can these works be carried out earlier? Because the congestion will not happened after you came late. This is already happening. These are the easier public works. Can they be carried out earlier instead of waiting till 2020 after completion of the current crematorium block, columbarium block? Second, so it's hard to estimate the pedestrian flow. My view is that if the Hong Kong need to tie with the smart city for the new escalators, we can install additional cameras to monitor the traffic, just to let the pedestrian know that whether there will be a congestion ahead, to let it decide that whether they come at a later or an earlier time. I think this measure will not inconvenience the public, would let the public to make a choice to arrange to come at their own time. These are the easier measures to adopt, so please answer that for me, Chairman. PAS, Ms. Wong, thank you very much, Ms. Thomas. If any supplement by ArchSD, maybe they can do so. As for the widening of the Cape Collinson Road, so, that was actually come along with the part of the project. The ArchSD can tell us whether they can start the social work early. As for the Wanchai Estate Westward Lane, and the department has been taken up, and most of the problems had already been resolved. And now we just are waiting for a work order. As for the members' comments on the escalator, it's actually a good suggestion. So I say it's going up and down. For during the peak, if they have a lot of people, they can only go have both going uphill, so they could double the capacity from 2,400 to 5,000. And we have an interdepartment working group, and actually to monitor the situation if necessary. Contingency measures, for example, making both escalators going in the same direction, that would be considered as well. Any supplementary question, Mr. Kwok? So you claim the RHST would can tell us whether you can expedite the project. For the widening of the Cape Collinson Road, it's a part of the Columbarium project. However, we will consider and we will ask the contractor to do it first in the package. Mr. Pun Xiuping. So every year, I will do grave sweeping. So the Qingming and the Chongyang festivals exert a lot of pressure on these locations. So I mainly want to find out that for this project, that you will build a five-story columbarium block that provided 25,000 niches. And for the item Paris 7, you mentioned that include the escalators and the widening of the Cape Collinson Road. For this 791.7 million, the project cost is inclusive of all these. So I would like to find out that you're encouraging green burials. For example, of like a remembrance garden and so on. For this columbarium facilities, would you consider providing such services as well? Thirdly, as for the escalator, of course I will support it because in the past there are a lot of people walking in that location. Of course, every year during the Qingming Chongyang festival, a lot of the elderly and the disabled would visit their loved ones. Would you consider providing a barrier-free access to these escalators? PAS. Later, I will defer to the RHST to elaborate. As for the cost, including columbarium block as well as the escalators, and for the details, the RHST can supplement. And we also take it seriously on for the PWD and elderly-friendly facilities, and there were a lot of the associated facilities incorporated. As for the Remembrance Garden, since we have a site constraint, in this case, we're not able to incorporate this facility. For the Cape Collinson area, the FEHD columbarium has already provided a new and the old Remembrance Garden. And now, available for the public, and in the future, if we are able to provide more Remembrance Garden, we will monitor the situation and follow up. Can I have LHST to explain? So the MEM's understanding is correct. The 790-something million is included the items listed in A2F in the document. It's for the very free access. The design of the block will fully comply the Buildings Department 2008 guidelines on accessibility. So there will be escalators in lifts and access disabled toilets and ramps in the building. Mr. Poon. And for the escalator works, can it be expedited? Or you have to build and complete it at the same time with a block, RHST, so it will complete at the same time. Next, Mr. Ray Chan, Chairman. According to supporting building more public crematoriums, the concern is that columbariums, is on the traffic. They set this study that for 7ENF, will be as sufficient to address traffic concerns, and that they would not provide a shuttle service. First, I would like to ask about the escalator, and in the document, there was a little inkling on that, for example, the cost of length, the trip duration. My first impression is like Ms. Chania Chen, is it going one direction or both? So I heard from PAS, claims that could be changed. So you know that the central escalator during the morning peak will be going down, and then an evening peak will be going up. So they were mostly upward traffic for the grave sweeping season. However, in actual operation, it is based on the pedestrian pattern, because they have to leave eventually. They can't wait for an hour or more. So you claim there are more pedestrian flow to going in one direction. So how would they leave, especially for families? And so, is the escalator open all year round, or would it be in sync with the Columbarium block, PAS? From Sun Ha Street going all the way to Cap Collison Road, it would take about 7 minutes. Besides the two escalators, we also have to provide a stairway. How long did it take to walk the stairway? It would be longer than 7 minutes. Oh, honestly, I can't tell how long. Depends on who's walking. There will be 5 staircases from Sun Ha Street going up. But the opening hours will be in sync with the Columbarium block, because during office hours, there will be visits to the Columbarium. Of course, the escalators will have sensors to detect human movement. How much of the escalator itself costs? There's about over 100 million. Oh, 170 million. For the direction. So you didn't have any particular ideas about what time would be on which direction. Depends on actual circumstances, because the FEHD colleague is present, and when the different government departments have observed that there are a lot of people waiting downhill, so that they would change into both going uphill. So when walking downhill with the staircase for the elderly and the children, will there be some difficulty for them?
Well, people can walk down, but the distance is a bit longer, I would say. At a stay place, well, they can opt to choose an old route, and that is through Lin Ching Row and Collinson, Cape Collinson. Ms. Tan Yu Chan refers to the 25,000 niches. Are you breaking them down into different categories? Some are for two sets of ashes and one for one. Well, 99% is standard niche, and 1% is for family use. Now, we have made a relaxation, and that is to say we will exercise our discretion to allow them to inter more sets of ashes there, if they like. Mr. Tommy Zhang, thank you, Chairman. The District Council discussed this paper, and the Liberal Party colleagues mentioned that if you are just going to provide for a pedestrian access route and not a lift, how should I put it? It's not good enough. Say, if somebody carries pigs, roasted pigs and other stuffs, and the escalator is so long, and if anything untoward happens, and it stops, and accidents may happen. And then you also said that if there is high pedestrian flow, the escalators will be going one way only, and people can opt to use the old route. So why are you adamant that you will not provide for a lift? Now, that would be good for the elderly and people who would be bringing stuffs to do their grave sweeping. How come that you are not considering it? Well, spend some more money to work on it. What's the difficulty? Under Secretary, can I defer to the RHSD to talk about the technical difficulties? Actually, we have heard members' views, and we have revised the plan. Say, we provide a wider podium in between the different sections of the escalators, and in case of accidents, there will be wide platforms for, say, the rescuers like the St. John's ambulance and so on. And I think it's very dangerous. Well, we don't want to see a repeat of the incident in Mong Kok, right? Now, for the escalator, that isn't good enough for the elderly who are not who will not be able to walk that easily. Why don't you consider providing a lift, HSD? Yes, we have considered that, but then the lift comes with limited capacity. So if we just count on the lifts to take people from Sanha Street to the project site, then it's the lifts can't cope with the demand. I hope that somebody, people like me, we're elderly and we are carrying stuffs to our graves weeping, then it's difficult. I'm not saying that you should do away with the escalator. I'm asking you to provide an additional lift. You are spending so much now, and it's not that the government is running short of money. Why don't you want to provide more convenience? Why don't you take care of the needs of the elderly? They do have to go to sweep graves, right? No, not only the elderly, but the disabled will find lifts more convenient. Does the government think the escalators suffice, HSD? Do you think escalators suffice? You have only 30 seconds. As to whether lifts should be provided, actually, we have studied into this internally. Now, we've heard your view today. We will again talk to the FEHD. Now, the Liberal Party will be supporting this project if you are going to provide a lift, or else we will not support you at the FC. Any other member wishing to ask a question, I have to make a count. Dr. Helena Wong, first round, myself, first round. And after we're finished, and if we do have time, we'll allow for a second round. Dr. Helena Wong, 4 minutes. Chairman, the DP, Democratic Party, will support constructing this columbarium block at Cape Collinson. Public niches are definitely in shortage. My question is on paragraph 3 of the paper, and it says that the government has identified 24 sites in the 18 districts in Hong Kong, and progressively the construction is taking place in certain sites. Out of the 24 sites, how many of them are yet to be worked on? Which district councils have not given the support, and what is your current plan, PAS, for the 14 sites? We have presented the proposals to the district councils. So we are providing 590,000 public niches, 2/3 of the total. How many sites have yet to be worked on, involving how many district councils? And now Fushan is turned over for building cemetery, and there are now 9 remaining sites to be worked on. Involving 9 district councils? Yes, more or less. For some of the sites, we haven't yet approached the district councils. It's not right to say that they are not giving us their support. Do you have a timetable on when these 9 sites will be worked on? How many of them have yet to be discussed by the district councils? What's your plan for presenting the proposals to the district council? Do you have such figures? Do you have such information? Can you provide the same to us? Yes. From time to time, we will provide a list of the sites in response to members' requests. Maybe we can't give you the exact month or date, but for the remaining 9 sites, we can give you a general picture of the latest situation. So now these are 9 sites yet to be developed. You don't want to introduce the proposals to the panels so soon. You want to take your time. We want to work on it ASAP, but well, let me take the Kuntong site as an example. It used to be a landfill. We have to revitalize the landfill before it can be put to use. So there are different circumstances which mean that not all sites can be proceeded with expeditiously, but we do have our plan. And so the time spans from 2001 to 2013, and we are progressively making the sites available. For these 9 sites, you have already earmarked them, and you are not going to sell them off for other uses. So the question is, for these 9 remaining sites, you will work them on slowly all the way up to 2013? No, not slowly. We will do it soonest. I have tried to explain how the situation is like. And some government departments will be asking us to, say, to hand over the sites for some temporary use, pending long-term development plan for the site. Now, we are a lot of people are waiting for public niches. People are waiting for public rental housing, and people are also waiting for niches. So you can also try to identify the needs after 2013, and you should not proceed too slowly. How come that you are just working on the Cape Collinson site and not the remaining 9 sites? We will give you a progress report of the 9 remaining sites. And for the other 14, we are proactively working on them. For example, Sandy Ridge, we have achieved certain progress, and there will be some 200,000 niches to be provided in that site. I can't give you a second round because some members have raised a question. And Dr. Kwakaki, you are the last member to raise your hand. I can't give you 4 minutes. Now, it's my turn. On behalf of the DAB, we support the project. My opinions is more or less the same of Tommy Chang. We're not asking you not to do to build the escalator, but there are people who do need a lift, and they would at the grave seeping season go to the columbarium. So I very much hope that the Azera government can consider seriously measures, not just limited to lift, to help the elderly people to go there. Well, the fruits are not light in weight. I myself wanted to take a roaster pig to the grave for worshipping. So I hope that the government can seriously consider doing more to help those in need. And earlier, the court has ruled that some lift or escalator maintenance operator was fined some $300,000 for failure in their maintenance works. So this is going to be a long escalator. How could you monitor their maintenance work? Now, if the one-way escalator is to be turned into a two-way escalator, how much more do we have to pay? I'm not from the sector, so I'm not very familiar with the cost. Well, maybe I have not made myself clear. During the busy hours, we can change it to a two-way operation, or rather one-way operation. And in normal times, the two escalators can provide two directional carriage. So, that's done through a program, right? Yes, I now understand. The EMSD will help us supervise maintenance works. I believe their experience is rich, and they've got a proven record in what they do. No major problem identified. So would you consider adopting other measures to help those in need, apart from providing for an escalator? We will talk internally, and then we will come back. You said that you would like to submit the proposal within this year. I don't know how long your discussion will take. Well, before we go to the PWSC, we will discuss it. So you mean that before you go to PWSC, you can promise to have a lift? No, no, we're just saying that we will give you a response. Now, if you are going to go to PWSC, even if you say that you don't want to add in a lift in the project, well, you can undertake some other project to help out. Maybe you say that you can't include that in this current project. Maybe you can come up with a separate project to help proposal. So we will reply in writing later on. I would like to mention this. A lot of members have asked about the issue on traffic, and there will be a rise in traffic demand in the area. So in your calculation estimation, you just don't take into account the current situation. Mr. Kok Wai Kwan said that the traffic is already congested. Now, if you underestimate the traffic volume, then we are going to there will be a lot of opposition. Dr. Kwakaki, 3 minutes, please. Chairman, you refer to the 25,000 niches. So, well, this cannot be sustainable, I would say. And there are two gardens of remembrance in Taiwan. Are they enough? Would that be a garden of remembrance provided in this site? For Eastern District residents, I don't know whether the government will bulldoze project through. They are the group which will sacrifice most. So when you allocate the niches, would you give priority to the Taiwan residents? Because they will be suffering a lot in terms of traffic and so on. So in allocating the niches, would you give priority to the residents and their families? Would you consider that? Concerning green burial, now you gave figures up to 2037, there will be a lesser demand for niches. More, 20,000 more family members or descendants will go there. And the FHD normally doesn't provide vending machines for drinks. Would you be providing, say, water fountains for people? And also, would there be any solar-powered installations and also installations powered by renewable energy and so on?
The IHSD can answer the question on this solar panel vending machines. And for weather priority for local residents, so the members are quite knowledgeable in the area. For the Cape Collinson, we have a new remembrance garden, both new and old. And due to site constraint, we're not able to provide in this facility. However, in building a new block, for example, in Chang Chui and Sa Leng, we'll provide a garden remembrance, Sandy Ridge, and we have a huge remembrance garden. As for the local residents, in the past, we have done some consultations. So we have 18 districts with different circumstances. For that district, they have a particularly large number in niches, while some districts do not. So there are different views on whether local residents should be afforded priority. So how are we kept an open position on this? In the future, we'll look at the community sentiments. So if you're at the Eastern District and you hold object while they've been friendly asking for Cape Collinson, you bring trouble to them. We understand that the comps in the public are justified. For example, if you're a local resident, you spend less time visiting the graves or niches. So the government will take into account the comps of the public as well as their rationale. Can you brief answer to remaining two questions? The water fountain, or because we ran out of time, so maybe provide a written response then. Good. So for this project, I've heard the Civic Party is against it, and the Liberal Party has some reservations due to the lift issue. Would the New People's Party support this with reservations? FTU support. and DAB support. So do we have a majority support? What you mentioned is that when they get to PWSC, they can promise to an extra to add that. I don't mean to stand away. So the Labour Party is supporting it. However, if they don't have the lifts, there will be more risk and they add to a lot of inconvenience to the disabled. If you are able to add that at the PWS application, that we will support. So because DAB is quite concerned as well, so that officials would take note, and so we have an overall majority support for the proposal. However, please take note of the members' concerns. Thank you. Well, now we move on to another item. Item number 5, the installation air conditioning system at Taiwei Market. Do we have the same government representatives? Yes. Okay, so we need to see the show of hands. I know it's a public concern. So we actually have a subcommittee on matters relating to public markets. However, this project you're not able to discuss in time for this subject, so we have to discuss it here. If in the future, when they that all the public markets project will discuss at this panel, and once the subcommittee had been established, then all these proposals would be for desk launches. We have 8 members who would like to speak. I'll let the Undersecretary to walk us through the document first. Okay, keep putting up your hands if you would like to question. As for installation of AC systems, the government has been quite concerned under improving the operating environment of markets. And based on the established mechanism to Taiwei Market back in 2014, that an overwhelming majority of the tenants, about 97%, have expressed support for the installed air conditioning. And the ArchSD, our discussion had have consulted the stakeholders on the proposals. And it was actually slightly complicated. Besides involving the stalled tenants, we have to involve the grander garden management offices and the owners incorporated upstairs. So is the consultative process quite complicated and takes some time. And finally, we will get to the stage of getting the funding. We expected that it would take 18 months in 3 phases. The first 2 phases, the market will keep operating for about 10 months. At the third stage, there will be a full closure of 8 months. As for the 8 months, will be used for the main installation works and major construction and other improvement works. And for the retrofitting of aircon, we are proactive in improving the environment of other markets. For example, the loading and unloading area, as well and installing elderly-friendly facilities. For example, lighting system, handrails, seats, disabled bathrooms, and so on. And back in 2016, this project was upgraded to Category B, and the capital cost was about 100 million. And hopefully, we can get approval by PWSC and the FC, and by the fourth quarter of 2018 that it can start and complete by the second quarter of 2020. That's the end of my introduction. So Mr. Hou Kai-ming had present us a motion, and I see that it's relevant to the item. If no other comments, then we'll deal with this motion. So have been distributed to members. And now on the list, we have 12 members like to speak, including myself. We'll discuss this through 4:15, so I believe there'll be problem going to second round, and the late coming incomes we're not able to allocate 4 minutes each. So let me read the list. Kwok Wai Kun, Siu Ka Fai, Pun Siu Ping, Tommy Cheng, Helen Wang, Wen Siu Kin, Eunice Yong, Dr. Fanny Cheng, O Chang Sing, Kwok Wai Fan, and myself, Hou Kai-ming.
4 minutes, 第一位, Kwok Wai.
4 minutes each. First, Mr. Kwok Wai Kang. I I think that the members who are concerned with the modernization markets will focus on the Taiwan market. What was afraid of the 18 months of the works period? Because these stall tenants claim that if they're going out of business for 18 months, how would they survive? And the customers have left. After 18 months, will they return? So these are their concerns. I hope the food FHB or the FHT can seriously address this to try to compress the construction period as much as possible. We got we'll just say it bluntly, just like the link own markets that could do a construction day and night to compress the construction time. For the Aberdeen public market has been queuing. So 18 months is the upper limit of tolerance. For the brewery and the FHT actually come with a 24-month proposal to reconfigure the stall tenants. So they're complaining 18 months is long enough. It's closed for 2 years. Are you trying to put us out of business? And yet I get the latest news that the FHB is conducting feasibility on the 24-month proposal. So we're already objecting to the 24-month proposal, and yet they take it to the feasibility study. And so we felt that the Met had been procrastinating through studies and consultation. So we have doubts. We question the FHB, the determination to expedite these projects. Or there's simply it's actually difficult enough to get 80% tenant support. So why you keep on procrastinating? So can we have high expectation HHB to compress the construction time and do so expeditiously to minimize the nuisance to stall owners and shoppers? Undersecretary. Thanks for members' comments. Today we'd like to focus on the Taiwan market. Like mentioned in the document, this works project will take 18 months in total. However, the full closure will only take about 8 months, of which the remaining 10, the market will keep operating. As for what they can do in construction day and night, the RGST can elaborate. However, besides having the store owners, the residents were also affected, so we can't work at nighttime. That's where the challenge is. However, for all the public market works, we tried to meet the needs of the stall tenants as to minimize the construction time, and since we understand the impact, so where technically possible, we'll do it. And I've asked Link that so for nighttime they will do some quiet works like installing facilities to cut the time, so they like to move the procedure, the workflow around that. RHST. So this project is used now because upstairs is the grander garden. For the Link REIT, they're probably in a standalone shopping center, so they might not be directly comparable. As for the Link works, as far as I know, they basically demolished everything and reconfiguring. Hotel market will keep most number of stalls. In this case, this is how we operate. So add to the difficulty. So under this precondition, we come up with the 18 months of construction period. Next, Mr. Andrew Xu. So the chief executive allocated $2 billion to renovate the most public markets. So the stall tenants have paid close attention to that because this will be an indicator of the future projects to come. So the sector have a few points to make. So well, in construction, the business will be disrupted. Is there having a nearby markets with vacant stalls where they could be temporarily relocated? For the Wong Tai Sin market being closed, they have a space for temporary stalls. I claim that there will be a closure of 8 months. let you claim 10 months, well, never mind. For a U1 estate renovation, it would take about 6 months. For the U1 wet public markets, I wonder can be expedited. Thirdly, on the air conditioning fee expense, that will be borne by the tenants. Like I said, this is actually for public enjoyment. So the cost will be borne by the tenant, which are passed on to the public. So they will add to the prices. So the sector will consider doing concessions on the aircon expenses. On the excretion payment, when they relocate all the fridges and major facilities will always be broken. Will there be any excretion payment for them? PAS. And these views have been raised during our consultation with installed tenants, and they will try to address as much as possible. As for whether temporary stalls offer, and actually a difficulty to locate, to identify stalls. However, the superintendent can add on the shut-in situation. And Mr. Xu mentioned about the closure of 6 months, just one estate of 6 compared to 8 months. As for different market have its own unique challenges. In this case, the RGST can explain why is it different from U1 and require 8 months. And for the air expense, aircon expenses, they've discussed at the panel many times. And while we discuss with the stall tenants, they were all clear that we have established policy of recouping the recurrent expenses. And yet for the capital costs for the aircon is borne by the government of 100 billion for the stall tenants and the public enjoyment. And for the actual arrangements, we'll try to work with these tent owners, and for example, they would not need to pay a rent waiver, and well as well, and no need to pay rent during the closure period.
Thank you, Chairman. On locating a temporary venue near Taiwai Market for the store tenants to continue operation. Actually, we have been trying to do this together with the district councillors and the residents that we are have an open mind towards that. We want to do that if possible. Mr. Peter Shill, you've got 10 seconds left. For the Taiwai store tenants, they have certain requests. They have, they said that after the air conditioning works have been completed, there will be a 1 year rental waiver. Second, there will be a 1 year waiver of air conditioning charge, and the air conditioning charge should be waived forever, permanently. And then there is this request for providing a temporary venue for them to continue operation while the works are being carried out. Mr. Pun Xiaoping, thank you, Chairman. I share the concerns raised by Mr. Jonathan Ho in his motion. They have explained the period of 18 months. Phases 1 and Phase 2 will take 10 months, and for Phase 3, full market closure is entailed for 8 months. So that will pose a great impact on the store tenants. They can't fend for themselves during this period. So what are the support measures the government will provide to them? And Mr. Jonathan Ho's motion is very clear. There should be a rental waiver and excretion payment to be dispersed. You said that phases 1 and 2 will not have a major impact. But of course, you're working on the plant rooms and so on. But those stores next to these plant rooms will be subject to some impact as well. So for these 10 months in the first two phases, the store tenants will also be affected. So how come that the government said that there will not be any impact? Second, Mr. Kok Wai Kwang has also asked that you can work on the noisy work procedures in the daytime and the quiet works in the nighttime, and that can help expedite the timetable. So if that is the approach, to be adopted, does it mean, what is the implication on the cost, and can it really shorten the works timetable? Now, for phase one, two stored poultry stores have to be reprovisioned. So that has to be done first in the phases one and two. So there will be minimal impact on the other stores because the other stores will continue operation. Whether we can work faster on the works, can we work round the clock? So can I defer to the HSD to reply on the question, and also how come that they think this is the best works approach? Can we work around the clock? The major consideration for us is the impact on Grandeur Garden. We know that Grandeur Garden is very concerned about the noise nuisance. So in the loading and unloading area, we have put in some noise. We will be put in some noise barriers. If works will take place at night, residents upstairs will be very concerned. So Mr. Poon is asking whether you can sequence the quieted part of the works during night, say for example laying the ducts, the electric cables and so on at night. Yes, I understand his question. Can we undertake quieter works at night? That is allowed by the Environmental Protection Department, that is true. We would have to consider whether that can really be feasible. Can we ask the contractors do that? But say if we are to carry some goods like metal, that still noise may be created. So we have to consider this. Yes. Mr. Tommy Jung. Thank you, Chairman. I declare that I patronize this market. My wife and I go to this market once every week. I think it's definitely feasible to carry out some works at night, but you want to save money. And if you... That can be done, but you have to understand the plight of the store tenants. So Mr. Peter Shiel asked made 4 points about rent waiver, waiver of air conditioning charge, providing excretia payment, and also providing temporary venue for store for tenants to continue operation. I'll give you some time to respond to these 4 points, because these 4 points are also in line with the 4 points made by Mr. Jonathan Ho. Deputy Director, thank you. Well, for your comment, let me talk about the established policy of the government and the installation of Taiwan market of air conditioner. We started the discussion in 2014. The government's policy, I know about this. I was a chairman back then. The Taiwan market store tenants came to oppose the project, and the full council forged a consensus. Members across different political parties have all along asked you to make improvements to the market so that the store tenants will be competitive and they can compete against the link tenants. So exactly, this is the basis on which we were discussing the project with the store tenants. Now, so what is the approach that we are taking now? Now, after the air conditionings have been installed, whether they should pay for the air conditioning charge, what the other markets are doing. So back in 2014, we were already set very clearly about policy, and in the suspension of business period. Now, after in 2015, when we did the consultation, the tenants were fully aware of our policies. We came with full transparency and discussing our approach. And then we followed up with a technical feasibility study. And in 2016, we agreed with the tenants on the approach before we proceeded with the project. So, well, we came with a proposal after we forged consensus among ourselves and the tenants on agreed basis. So, Mr. Tommy Zhang, are you confident that you will be able to identify temporary venue for them? Are there any vacant stores in other markets to be made available for them during these several months? They live from foot to mouth, and they have to support for their families. As what the hygiene superintendent said, we have an open mind on that. If there are vacant stores in other markets, we will provide them to the tenants. I am asking whether you have the confidence to do this. We would do our utmost to assist them. Can the hygiene superintendent supplement? We are proactively identifying locations near Taiwan market for this purpose. We are working together with the tenants and the district councillors to identify locations for our temporary market. Well, we've discussed this before. They might be willing to give waiver for air conditioning charge. Well, but then we said that the common areas, the air conditioning charge of the common areas should not be borne by the store tenants. That should be the responsibility of the government. So do you support this project? Yes. Okay, the government, please pay heed to his views. Dr. Helena Wong. Dr. Wong, you have to say whether you support this project. Well, let me ask questions first. So, just now, the government said that it is trying to identify location in the vicinity of Taiwan market to provide a temporary market during those 8 months. So, do you have any idea? Do you have any plan? Where will that location be? Any place that can be that is suitable? Superintendent, store tenants have proposed a soccer pitch or playground nearby. We are talking to the LCSD. Of course, this playground has its own purpose. We'll have to look at the actual timetable, and then we will further discuss with the LCSD and the store tenants. So you are borrowing the LCSD's soccer pitch or playground to organize a bazaar for the tenants to sell fruits and vegetables and so on. So, that you're going to borrow that venue for a certain period, or you are going to take over that venue wholesale? Well, we're talking about this 8 months, and if he can borrow this venue for entire 8 months, that would be best. This is a soccer pitch. So if the LCSD is willing to have you use the soccer pitch, then it means that no soccer can be played during that period. Is that right? Yes, well, thank you for your follow-up, Dr. Wong. And well, there can never been a fate can plot which we can use handily. This is a soccer pitch which is now being used, right? So there is a give and take, of course. Different people have needs for different facilities. Have you consulted the residents on their preferences? Whether they would like to have a market there or like to play soccer there. Now, different stakeholders have their different or own considerations. You have to talk to the district councillors, the residents, and the store tenants. Well, we have to come up with a balanced option. And that is exactly where the difficulty lies. But we are obliged to do it. Well, there are a lot of gives and takes, I understand. Please try to do the best consultation job. It's very critical that we have a temporary public market, or else people will be very much inconvenienced. Now, on the question of installation of air conditioner, all political parties support the improvement of public market facilities, and there is already a subcommittee established for that. And Carrie Lam, when she assumed office, she said that she would adopt new thinking in dealing with public market issues. So is the government so adamant on the 80% threshold for installing air conditionings in public markets, or do you have new thinking? This is an important issue that we have to deal with. We have this 80% because we want to make sure that this is a mainstream view, and that will help in us in taking forward the project. We have to deal if we have a mainstream support, that will help us. Now, can we lower it to, say, 75% or 70%? Well, please. As you know, said in our paper, there is this $2 billion 10-year market modernization program to be rolled out. We try to work on the markets in the most efficient way. We want to install air conditioning. So all these will be subsumed under the market modernization program. Mr. Andrew Wan, I would like to ask something about the temporary market venue. What kind of soccer pitch is that? Is it a large-sized one or medium-sized one or what? So can that can you answer that question for us? Is this seven-a-side, five-a-side, turf pitch, grass pitch, or what? Is a turf pitch. I'm not sure how big is it. This is very relevant. I'm not going to repeat the questions raised by members. In Yumen Lane, when it was being dismantled, and right next to the bus terminus, there was a two-story temporary market built. And it was built of steel and egg-shaped steel frames. And it was made mainly of glass and metal and so on. And that could help. Really, so can we understand that we have to give and take? Well, if the HAB uses the same approach in dealing with the golf course, then that would be very good. But can you undertake that you would provide a temporary public market venue? Now, if that's a very big venue, then you might not be, say, use up all the space. So if that is the case, maybe you can use half of the plot for the public market and leaving the other half still as football pitch.
I agree with Mr. Tommy Cheung that the construction costs paid by the government and the aircon charge will be borne by the tenants. There's some unfairness in that. So taking the usual management concept, you have the common areas and the private area, even though you don't have a deep public confidence. However, based on the tenants, okay, you know the share, pro rata shares, instead of completely borne by them. And the official replies claim that for the at a budget of $2 billion. For the $2 billion, would it be enough for the 10 markets that we install AC? For the other markets, would it be enough for all of them? So I hope the estimate provided. Deputy Director, so for the common areas, the corridors, in the past, we have discussed that many times in this panel, and our position was clear. And we have actually discussed at the subcommittee, so we can elaborate on that. So right now, you don't have a position yet. So this is current policy, and it's based on this policy that we have discussion with the tenants whether we will install air conditioning. So they agreed with installing on this basis. And secondly, as a temporary measure, we will try to help wherever we can. as well as members have made other possibilities when answered to Dr. Helen Wang, they are give and take. So how do we strike a balance? So we're willing to explore. And for the $2 billion allocation, this is an important question. We just issued a document to give our preliminary thoughts, and the subcommittee will discuss in detail. Our position is that the purpose is to utilize this $2 billion to expedite the upgrading of the public markets that are ready for upgrading. So if we ran out of money, we'll apply for more funding. But the importance is to get results. I haven't got a concrete reply for the last two questions, so I should accept that for the time being. I found the first question problematic. Discussing on an unfair basis, so you have a lot of questions unwilling to install AC. So you're using the same old tune, yes, come to new thinking. You're not solving the question. So we discuss it at a subcommittee then. Eunice Young, I support the installation of AC system in Taiwan market. My views is that are similar to the motion by Mr. Jonathan Ho. So for the 18 months in which they are running for 10 months and closure for 8 months, so are there views mentioned, can this construction time be compressed? Now that we have reserved just about $100 million for the installation, if we would compress the time, will lead to a higher cost, or if we're able to give more allocation, can you actually compress the construction time? So I will let the architect explain on the technical level. However, when planning for the installation, we don't put out a proposal at random. So we have considered the technical and engineering possibility, and with the discussion with the stall owners, as well as getting funding from the central level, and the proposal we give out is a balanced proposal. So whether we can put more money to expedite it, I'll let the IGST explain. Why? Because resources may not be the most overriding concern that would let that led to this 8-month closure of what only $100 million. So maybe the IGST can provide it with a technical explanation. Mr. Chair, for the nighttime construction, there will be noise we're not able to control. Like I mentioned, the Thai market has its unique challenges. Most of the stalls will need to be preserved, and during construction, these preserved stalls actually brought constraint to the contractor. And since this is installing the AC, so 8 months may sound very long, but however, for the last 2 months is reserved for testing and fine-tuning of the AC system, so that by reopening, the AC system will be running smoothly. So these are timeline are offered under careful consideration. I noticed that these stall tenants hope to the early completion. However, this 8 months closure is as a result of careful and extensive consideration. So my question is reflecting the tenants' concerns. So the 8 months closure of the yet of a temporary market, they need to switch jobs. So this is a matter of survival for them. So if the resources is available, so if we add more manpower, we can compress the construction time. I hope the government can reconsider. Second question on maintenance fees. I would like to know the maintenance fees borne by the store owners in other markets, and so how do you reach consensus with the store owners in this area? Mr. David Wong, when are we opening? We're just adopting the established practice in which the recurrent expenses, for example, maintenance and AC charge, were borne by the tenants. So we discussed that with the tenants. For every month, the AC charge, including maintenance per square foot, is about $127 to $210 per square meters. So that will show the indicator how much AC cost they will need to bear. So we have 45 members who would still like to speak. I hope that I don't wish to ring the quorum bell. Next, Dr. Fernando Cheung. This Taiwan market is famous for being the hottest market in Hong Kong. I think the government, when starting this market from the outset, they should install AC. And the stuffiness inside, and all the councils from NEEs have all followed up on this market. The chickens actually passed out inside. The meat, since it was so hot, and the meat would actually turn bad, or even get
mean. 佢哋嗰啲豆腐檔咧
desiccated,
太升得太
They actually need to add ice to the tofu service.
一二年選
I never seen.
咁啊，我
market as ridiculous as this. And finally, it's actually coming. However, I found the conditions very stringent. You need to require to close down for 8 months. I'm asking you to suspend work for 8 months. Suspend of 8 months, and for this 8 months, I'm not charge you for medical insurance. So you'll be suspended without pay, and I let you resume your duties after 8 times. And there are workers employed there. In these 8 months, the machinery will be damaged. The fridge will malfunction when stopped for 8 months. And I'm sure, Chairman, you actually know about this. So if you leave the equipment there, they will get rotten. So their tools of trade work broken. So their business will be affected in 10 months of construction. So now that would you seriously consider setting a temporary market? And for the compensation, would you improve that? As for the maintenance, you don't have to pay, shouldn't have to pay for it. And if you rent a premise and the aircon was broken, and then you can't replace the aircon yourself, and it should be borne by the landlord. So can you improve on the basic conditions? So I give the government some time to respond. And Deputy Director, so we noted the members concerned, and we noted that the about 60% of the markets are built after pre-1990. Back then, the community expectations and the government demands were different, and no matter what, we are determined to improve the operating environment for the benefit of shoppers and store owners. As you claim that 8 months is a quite long time, so we respond to previous members' inquiries that we understand where it falls short. So we try to compress the work period as much as we can and finally arrived at the 8 months. If there are difficulty for the time period, we may explain with the superintendent. We're willing to consider temporary measures to see if the 166 stall owners of, who would need that and will assist them. And for maintenance, our position all along is that the replacement of the aircon will be cost borne by the government. Is that daily maintenance and the operation arrangements, since we're charging management fees. However, we don't charge management fees. We just charge the AC charge and the maintenance fees. So we do whatever we can under existing policy. Can you extend the rent waiving period to 1 year? Currently, this is a best conditions offered, and we'll be discussing with the stall owners based on this proposal. Next, Mr. Oh Chong Sing. Chairman, my colleagues have focused on the closure period. Like the PS, this has served that, and you note the members' comments, and will act consider them. Can you tell us afterwards that whether you can shorten the construction time? And tenants and its owners, maybe that could be resolved in 6 months and reopened. And I heard that you can consider it, and I hope they hear the good news. I support the installation of AC in public markets. If you're not keeping pace with the time, the patronage and the operating environment deteriorating, I hope they can step up pace. At the community level, the installation of AC at the preliminary phase as during construction involved a lot of coordination with departments, for example, HSD, AMSD, the EPD, and FSD, and so on. Can I ask the government, how can you enhance the coordination or resolve the usual obstacles? So what sort of coordination problems that slow down the progress? In the afternoon, I've discussing with the Undersecretary on the public markets. I just would like to know more before I come with supplementary question. Thank you, Mr. Orr's question and observation. So we're definitely not gonna pull a fast one. So we need to go through PWSC and the relevant panel just to get account of the situation. As for the members' comments, hopefully to compress the construction time, that is very clear. So we do whatever we can. We work with the HSDs of how much room we can maneuver, and if not, then how we go on with the temporary market. And in the past, back in 2014 to 2018, we have done a lot of work to come with this proposal. I'd like to make one point on a coordination. Because a government is a big organization with different departments, to manage a market or care of public works, different departments will be involved, whether there will be working more in sync, an always important issue within government. And for the FEHB, they need to consider all the coordination. Because the last year policy address, it was mentioned that they will step up the service of public markets and build new markets. There also a $2 billion allocation specifically for the upgrading. And back this January, and thank for the support of the council, we have create a directory post to lead a designated task force to handle this. So now that I have the resource and the manpower and the policy, we hope that it will lead to better coordination. Hopefully in future, we can serve the public to meet the needs of the public and the shoppers.
Chairman, I hope that before they go to the FCU or other committees, tell us how you're going to compress the timetable. Give us a proposal. And also, I would like to follow up on this, how you're going to enhance coordination among government departments. The greatest problem lies in the internal procedures, because circulation of papers within the government departments usually takes a long time, and there's been a waste of time. So can you give us a paper to tell us how you're going to improve the situation? You have the money now, you have the new directorate post, so I don't see any reason of you stalling the matter further still. I've drawn a line. Mr. Raymond Chen, thank you, Chairman. I've been following up on the Taiwan market issue since the last term of Lichko. While they've been really moving slowly, there was a questionnaire survey in 2014, and a course of consensus was forged. 2018 commencement of works, 2020 construction completed. I know that you will pick up the pace later on. I record in June 2014, I was having a shooting program there in 2014. And a lot of problems have been mentioned by Dr. Fernando Zhang. And these two tenants were already finding business very difficult. If you are a really young person, you are very ambitious, you won't stay in the market. There isn't any prospect for you. Those who are really keen on their business will have already left. It's so hot. We've been discussing this starting 2014. That was the situation back then already. So we have to support this project. But the question is how we can we do the best job and be best to the store tenants. You said that for the phases 1 and 2, there will be no rental waiver. For the 8 months, there will be rental waiver, and then there will be additional rental waiver for the additional 2 months. But you haven't given a breakdown on the period for phases 1 and 2, and it doesn't say how long each phase will last exactly. Maybe in these first 10 months, there will be less patronage, and maybe you have to waive the rental. So you say that there will not be any impact in phases 1 and 2. Now, apart from reprovisioning the two poultry stores, there may be other stores, vegetable stores, etc. affected. But do the store tenants know about the arrangement? Some people earlier said they don't know what's going to happen. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. The superintendent will elaborate. Now, there are 166 stores. Seven will be affected by the works, including the two poultry stores. And maybe the superintendent can elaborate more. Mr. Chen referred to the timetable. We understand that it's quite a long period. It may not be to everyone's satisfaction. But we spent some time to talk over the different options with the tenants. We needed to apply for funding, etc. Now, in the future, we're going to have a $2 billion fund. So hopefully, we can more flexibly use the funds and speed up the works. What is the exact period in relation to phases 1 and 2? And can there be any concessionary measures or waiver? For phase 1, 2 months. Phase 2, 8 months. During this period, the market will continue to operate. Of course, the works area will be hoarded off or fenced off. According to our policy, if phases 1 and 2 have an impact on certain stores, the store tenants will have their rental waived. What do you mean by impact? Maybe they will be subject to the influence of the dust, the noise, and the customers may be affected, and so on. There is only one story for in Taiwan market, and there will be a rental waiver of 50% for the affected tenants. What about those which are going to be reprovisioned? Maybe they can reply in writing. I can briefly talk about the seven stores. We've talked to each and every one of them, and they know exactly where their store will be located in the future. And we have even discussed with them the detailed design of the chicken or the poultry stores. Dr. Elizabeth Quart has submitted a motion, and I think it's related to the subject matter, so we're going to deal with it. We don't have enough time. I will draw a line. Dr. Kiki Kwok has raised her hand. I can't allow him to speak again because I have already drawn the line. Next one, Dr. Quart, you can now speak. Thank you, Chairman. We've been following up on the Taiwan market for a very, very long time, and we've talked to different offices at the district. This is a very hot market. Well, up to 40 degrees or so. Well, the meat, the pork will get rotten, the fish will die, and the chicken will faint, and people will faint. So it's 80% of the store tenants have signed up to have air conditioning. We want it to be done quicker. And the store tenants will be affected tremendously. So I'm moving a motion saying that since the government has new resources, can we dish out extra payment or what? So the store tenants hope that the works can be expedited and shorten the closure period to 6 months, because these people live from hand to mouth. Now, after the market is reopened, they hope that there will be a one-year rental waiver and air conditioning waiver, because for the 8 months in the closure period, many customers would turn to other markets and they may not come back. So they have to need some time to recover the business lost. And for some stores, the tenants heard that maybe these stores are subject to bidding, and they are concerned that the rentals may rise and that the cost may be passed on to the commodity, the consumers. So they don't want a bidding to be put in place. Now, during the several months of market closure, they don't have an income, and the paraphernalia is subject to wear and tear. So can the government give them some compensation, extra payment, and also for the air conditioning charge, maintenance costs, etc.? They want these to be borne by the government. So these is the requests from the store tenants. Maybe you had a lot to talk to them in the past, and you didn't go into these details. Now, it's going to be implemented very soon, so I hope that the government can take a more compassionate approach, try to understand the plight of the tenants and help them as much as possible. If we have the resources, we can, I'm sure, that compress the timetable. There might be some hurdles, but try to appreciate the difficulties faced by the store tenants. I hope that you can lend a helping hand. Deputy Director, Dr. Quart, thank you for your comments. We have to be mindful that the overall principle that public funds should be used fairly and justly. We will try to consider some of your recommendations. We will try to work on them. Now, if the store tenants cannot operate for 8 months, so can more be done to help them? Can we shorten it to 6 months? We will respond to members in writing as to how we can do that. There are definitely bound to be technical difficulties. So if the timetable cannot be shortened, can we provide alternative sites for the 160 store tenants to continue operation? We will continue to talk with the hygiene superintendent. 7 out of 166 store tenants will be affected, because we have to put in place the transformer rooms, etc. So we have to be allocating the store space. The fair approach is to put them up for bidding. Well, they think otherwise. Now, air conditioning charge, this has to be shared out, and it is on this basis that we talk to the store tenants and on which we have forged a consensus with them. Next one, Mr. Jonathan Ho. Thank you, Chairman. My motion contains the recommendations of the store tenants. I hope that members can support it. Now, the administration said that you have this established policy of aircon charge. You mean user pays principle? Well, if that is the case, I don't know why. If I say visit a library, I use an LCSD table tennis court, I'm not charged aircon fee, right? Now, public markets are there to provide a service, a shopping service for members of the public, and the store, you've invited the store tenants to sell and provide a service to members of the public. So the members of the public are using government facilities, right? And you are not charging me extra aircon charge or fee when I visit a library or use a table tennis court. So how come that the tenants are asked to pay the electricity charge? Thank you. I don't think these are comparable scenarios. These are the leisure facilities that you are referring to. Now, the store tenants are operating on a commercial basis, and they are abiding by the law in whatever they do, and they have to pay profits tax if they earn a profit. So So they have to pay a rental to operate their stores. And so Deputy Director, if you consider them as commercial facilities, now, so else we are really providing these all these necessary facilities to convenience the public. These are places that members of the public must patronize or use. So you know this very well. Well, the major reason why sometimes you can't reach the 80% threshold is because the tenants don't want to pay a charge. So that has always been the obstacle for reaching the 80% threshold. Since in the budget, $2 million has been set aside for public markets, is it the case that you can you can't adjust your policies? Must you charge a conditioning charge? Why don't you adjust your policy and waive the aircon charge? Thank you, Mr. Ho, for reminding us. Let me give you the background of the policy. This is not the first day that we were discussing this subject, but since we have this funding proposal, then I'm reminding you of our discussions in the past. What is the established policy? In the last term of the LegCo at the relevant subcommittee, we have had lengthy discussions on the positioning, the operation of public markets. We had set our stance very clear, and there was also a consultancy report setting out the various situations. This is very much a policy matter, and Mr. Ho referred to this policy. So that's why I am setting this out also clearly back then. For the new management companies of link shopping centers, when they want to charge NGOs air con charges or management fee, the CSF4A has instructed that only $5.5 be charged as management fee per square foot. So if FEHD is charging the store tenants the aircon charge, then it would be acting like the new property management companies of Link, and that should not be the case. I've visited the Taiwan market twice. Now we have to deal with two motions. We don't have the quorum now. So as I speak, please, members upstairs, please try to come down. I will not have the quorum bell rung.
So every year a visit to the visits become a institution for the DAB. So you had to visit once or twice every year. So maybe during summer or during the fall. So it's like for a disaster relief. So back in 2014, the government planned to install air con, and we all feel positive there were intra-party support for this. By 2018, so finally we have a approval coming up, and yet this process is tortuous. We're still arguing what to do with the AC charge and whether we can compress the construction period. So the public markets upgrading policy lack long-term consideration. They probably take it one step at a time. So let's say for a particular block, after 10 years, they will require large-scale maintenance. So do we have 10 years to discuss the stall owners or tenants to relocation and so on? If there low occupancy, we can have more bazaars or temporary stalls. So the stall tenants, they will have a reasonable expectation how to allocate resources. So instead that let me have 2 years left on my tenancy, I'll just object to the installing AC. We have a tenants like this. So we don't have a reasonable duration on this. So the stall tenants and members, when they are in dispute with the AC charge. So if I make money, it's okay for me to pay extra $100, $200, even $1,000 per month. So how you plan to improve the management and the environment, especially it's high Y. So it took 3 months to replace a fluorescent lamp. Now, can I change it, replace it myself? Nope. The RHSD will dispatch staff to handle that. Just ossified bureaucracy have led to a lot of discontent. So for any small gesture for fine-tuning, the administration will give a think about the whole picture. So the last year we have a committee, subcommittee on matters are relating to public markets. Just have discussed with the government that how to correct the path or to ascertain the role of the government or how to expedite the process so that the tenants' wishes can be expressed or to satisfy their demands. Take, for example, like a change of fluorescent lamp or a broken tiles. They couldn't be done in time. So the government will need to reduce the resistance to such projects. And secondly, the government that I know is a huge organization, so to have different departments dealing with different subjects. However, we shifting responsibility to one another. I can't say they claim the expertise or the expert opinion claims that that led to a risk of ruling that out. For example, when you ask RHSD whether they can leave the quiet construction at nighttime, so it would rule out the possibility. Though this is not a convincing reason to persuade a member and the public that what they're afraid of is because that you're afraid that there will be complaints received while bringing the materials and to convince the public and the stall owners. So it's a matter of a poor explanation to the public. I know where your difficulty. I hope that we can work together because the tower market has dragged on for too long. For DAB, I'll support this project. And next, we'll deal with two motions. We have a quorum, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. So we only have 8, actually. We need 11. So we need to ring the quorum bell then. So as soon as we reach quorum, then we'll reach quorum. So let's have the quorum bell rung first. So we're not gonna take attendance. I'll just read out the motion.
Jonathan
Ho's motion, please read it out. This council urged the government to consider following measures on the installation AC system in Taiwan market to mitigate the impact of the construction work, including rent waiving for 1 year for store owners and set a temporary market nearby the market for the continue their business, and to give extra payment to the affected stall tenants, as well as to waiving the maintenance as the AC charge for these tenants. Those who are in favor, put up your hand. Those against? Abstentions. 11 in favor, 0 against. This motion is carried. Second motion is moved by Ms. Dr. Joseph Quad. The tenants of the Taiwan market had their business suffered greatly due to the installation of AC. The council urged the government to implement following measures to expedite the work progress, to reduce the closure to no more than 6 months, and the reopening of the market would waive the rent and the AC cost for 12 months, and to negotiate the relocation arrangements for negotiation instead of bidding. And since the lack of income during the installation, as well, there will be a wear and tear when the closure or the equipment for a bit idle, there will be compensation extra payment for the store tenants, as well as to the government waiving for the AC cost and the maintenance and cost to be borne by the government. Those in favor? Those against? Abstention. 12 in favor, no abstention, no objections. Motion carried. Thank you all. Last item. Replacement of radio communication system at the Food and Environmental Hygiene Department. Undersecretary, please start when you're ready. This has to do with the replacement of radio communication system of the FEHD. And in the past, we rely on communication system when the frontline officers discharging duty, especially the hawker control teams, they need to have proper communication and backup. The old system are using an analog system, and the design in operation is rather outdated and not keeping in pace with our current requirements. So after trial a replacement into a digital system will help our colleagues to seek backup, get information, and well, instead of emergency alert system. I believe this replacement is essential. We're now beginning trials, and it shows that I'm able to help the frontline, hope to get the funding to replace the entire system. That's the end of my introduction. So it's concluded. Any questions from members? So we only have one, and not even our member. Mr. Charles Mock, 4 minutes. I'll allow you second round later. Since I'm not a member of this panel, however, on this subtopic matter, I'm quite interested. So in use from 1985, this is almost an antiques. I don't quite understand, maybe you can explain to me. Do we really need sort of a radio communications or using other communication system can achieve all the purpose? So what special reason would you require this? So I glanced through requirements that they would fall down and they were able to detect by the handsets. But I think the smartphone can actually do it nowadays. You claim there are data encryption and so on can be fulfilled by smartphones. So the police have a second, third, fourth generation communication system. So why do we need this system to install base stations and so on? Undersecretary or Deputy Director, it's more a question more than comments. So my colleague will supplement. So we have our own designated system to allow the batmates to communicate with the console for deployment. And in emergencies, with special functions ready, I think a communication system is essential. And would need to be tailored to our operation needs, which will be ideal. Instead of using a cell phone, that is our basic premises. So even the other departments like the police and the FSD or the ambulance and the CSD, and so while they would dispatch staff, that will require communication among another or with the command center to ensure deployment or responsiveness in emergencies. A designated system is a starting point. So I would like my colleague to explain, Mr. Lam, Assistant Director at BHD. I think remember's question. For this communication equipment, that will be for different frontline officers communicating with the command center or the console. So let's say a cell phone, and if they're carrying this handset, they need to press one button because all the channels had already been preset. They would not need to dial on their phone because dialing would not able to allow peer-to-peer communication. So you answered part of my concern. Well, maybe for some special equipment that rely on a public network that achieved quite a number of functions, I'm not going to argue with this. And for the coverage, you need to install the base stations or transmitting stations. So how big is the coverage? So Mr. Wang mentioned for the police and FSD, they will need to have a territory-wide coverage. But for this, we only covered some district where for the hawker control areas. So we have FBH divided into 19 regions. All of them, we have hawker control teams.
So it will be covered. In paragraph 7, for the six districts where there is a trial, we have set out the number of base stations that have to be set up. So this is a feasible option proposed after studies by undertaken by the EMSD. Mr. Peter Xiu Ka-chan, on the replacement of radio communication system of the FHD, well, in terms of enhancing the work efficiency of the hawker control teams, that I would not oppose the project. But from the perspective of the hawkers, well, they may raise a number of questions. In the past, HCDTs of FHD have a conflict with the residents. For example, in the middle of last year, a 75-year-old old lady had to hand over the card boxes to a foreign domestic helper and got $1, and her card boxes were confiscated, and there was a strong opposition from the community, and 13,000 people signed up to a petition to oppose this, and later on the FHD withdrew the charge. So if the government, I mean the FHD, just considered improving environmental hygiene disregarding the harmonious relationship among the residents, and even high-end technology will not help you, and those who are going to suffer ultimately will be the frontline officers. So my question is, apart from improving the radio communication system, will the government commit more resources to improve relationships with the community? And second, I'm afraid that the chairman will say that I'm I'm digressing. I have to talk about this. Now, for the use of this radio communication system, under what circumstances will they push the emergency button? Will there be any guidelines? Is there any mechanism to ensure that the staff will not make exaggerations? Because there is also this man-down function of this radio, new radio system. Now, if there is this man down, there, if this person falls down, then there will be alert to be sent to the console. So when will the guidelines be issued? Will there be cases where the aviation colleagues are framing the hawkers? So we understand that there is some sensitivity to this issue, and we want the environmental hygiene to be improved, but at the same time, we have to deal carefully with public perception. For every district, we have a district council, we have our superintendent attending the meeting, and we want to make sure that there is called a relationship between our frontline staff and the hawkers, so that the hawker control work can be done in the best way. So we want to do a better job continuously. So we want to do better. Well, this is very much a system which is replacing the analog approach. We will provide a sufficient training to our staff to make sure that they know how to use the functions of the system. Now, this amend down function can help the hawker control team members to deal with emergency situations. So if there is someone abusing the system, then the supervisor will have to deal with it and have to make amends and rectify the misbehavior of the staff members. Mr. Pun Xiaoping. Well, the paper shows that your old system has been in place for 30 years, starting from 1985, and the old system will be phased out, and the manufacturers will not produce the spare parts anymore, and the coverage may not be that extensive in the old system. There is no GPS. So starting 2016, you implemented a pilot scheme in three areas, including Central and Western, Yaoqim, and Sha Tin. And for this new digital system, after your testing and pilot, you found that the results are satisfactory. And then in mid-2018, you will extend the pilot run to Southern Mongkok and Chinwan districts. My question is, why did you choose these three districts? That will be launched in mid-2018, and you plan to apply for funding for the entire system in 2018. Now, first, why these three districts? Now, if the pilot run of the latter three districts find that the results are different, are you still going to push through this system? And if that cannot be done, how long? Much longer will the old system last, because it started in 1985. Thank you, Mr. Poon, for your question. The EMSD professionals have proposed for this digital system to replace the old analog system. This is a right direction, and we must do it. We have this professional advice from our colleagues. But then we have to test out whether it really works. Now, for some districts, we think that the old system has flaws and there might be blind spots. No matter how much improvement we make on the analyst system, it is still not good. So we have picked these districts and we try to run the digital system in these districts. We put in place a base station, and the colleagues will be given our handsets to ascertain whether the problem of blind spots can be overcome. And then we will try to extend the system to the entire three areas. So we have picked these three districts, and generally we think that the results are satisfactory. So we are coming you to get the funding. So apart from these three districts, we'll try to pilot run the system in three other districts, because each district differs in its circumstances. So we want to be prudent. We want to work on three additional districts. It won't affect the taking forward of the system generally. And in writing the tender documents, we can fine-tune the wordings. Such experience will help us. So overall we think that this digital system is recommendable, and we think that it can help us do our daily work. Have you compared yourselves against other communication, using such communication systems? Have you made comparison on cost effectiveness, etc.? The EMSD has taken a look at the experience of using similar communication systems when they came up with the proposal. They have taken a look at the different proposals. For FEHD, we have 19 districts, and we have different HCTs. We have handsets, we have base stations, etc. This is the most optimal approach, they think. Now it's my turn, and then two other members would like to ask for a second round. I can't give you 5 minutes. I want to adjourn the meeting on schedule. Now, this system has been in use for several decades. The government want to update it, replace it, because the end manufacturer was not producing the spare parts anymore. So it's they have every reason to replace the system. But then I still have some doubts on the some of the points mentioned. They have not adopted new approach to resolve upcoming problems. Now, in 6F, you said that there will be a GPS, and there will be emergency button, man down, etc. And well, for some of the functions that can be, they are functions now provided by the mobile phones. So man down, what do you mean by that? You can have a Bluetooth, and also for a portable radio handsets, you can deal with it through Bluetooth, and then you have to put in base stations, etc. The cost will be relatively high, because you're talking about $56 million here, and you are not adopting advanced or innovative thinking to address upcoming challenges. So I have query on the cost effectiveness. So can you address that concern first? We have 19 districts, and each district has its own HCTs and also HCTFS, and 190 squads as well. For every squad member, we will try to take care of the need when we design the system. The member mentioned about man-down function for the handset. It comes with functions or devices whereby when the user falls down on the ground, the man down function or the emergent function will be activated, and the message will be sent to the console, and then the console will know exactly where the member is at the electronic map, because we will have the GPS. So this is very much a safety device to ensure that in the 19 district, the 119 squad members, if they are in such difficulty, then we'll be aware of it. And the council will know where the other team members are. So this is very much a forward-looking approach, and we want to make sure that every team member will be safeguarded. How many portable radio handsets would you purchase? You talk about 190 squads. How many handsets will you buy? Chairman? 1,163 handsets. Let me add, Chairman, now even for the AFCA and also the existing communication system, there are still blind spots. And we want to be forward-looking going forward. We want to add in new functions in this digital system. So in paragraph 7 of the paper, we list the functions to be provided based on our needs. Say, for example, we have electronic map, GPS. These are the functions which can help our colleagues in discharging their duties. So my time's up. I will save it for my second round. We still have time. Mr. Charles Smock, first round, 3 minutes. The several government offices have said that on the one hand, they would like to have their own network. This is very much the norm. But I don't see the necessity. In 7F, these are the new features added. These are the functions which can be provided by mobile phones, smartphones, and there are so many apps, and you want it, this is a communication device, and you want to add in so much functions which are already available in mobile phones. I really don't see the necessity here. I can't answer, or I can say for sure why FSD needs it. Maybe they are in different situation, and maybe they want to cover the entire territory. They want to have more stringent security measures and so on. But I don't see hawkers, the possibility of hawkers having to eavesdrop you and so on. So your scenario may be different from the FSD. I'm not standing in the way of this proposal. That's not what I want to do. But I would like to understand more clearly the necessity for this, because going by what you said, I'm not convinced that there is this need. And also the question on the base stations. You said that you will be building base stations. Would they be built, say, at markets, or at what locations will they be put? Deputy Director. Well, after the meeting, we're more than happy to talk to Mr. Mok on why we need the system to ensure that they can effectively discharge their duties. We also talked to our frontline staff when we designed the system. They think that it will assist them. No, maybe they. We think that this system will work for them.
And for the Paris 7B, that this is actually used on a cost-effective basis, and we're using the ROIP technology to connect the console and the radio stations using existing network. So that will be quite cost-effective. And for the E and F, for the functions mentioned, it's just need to have a slight tweaking of the system, and to actually meet the operation needs as well. So I'm asking that how you install the base station. APA, don't need to answer the email, or maybe we can discuss at a later stage. For the 19 districts, would they install government facilities or the lampposts? And so I can discuss with the member later. Dr. Xu Ka-chun, so let me talk about the main stance. So and for the scavenger and the hawkers, the administration had this crackdown attitude. The more advanced technology will become led to more savage outcomes. So my question may seem to be out of scope. However, I would like to have some policy that is friendly to scavengers and the old ladies. Would the FEHT can work with other departments, including HAB and LCST, to seriously consider if there any room to make them store properly their cardboards? why, well, you think I'm being out of scope. However, we need to have a friendlier policies while taking on this technology upgrades. And for the fall down function, man down function, you consider forward looking. I found so when I asked about the man down function. So when would it be activated? How far do you have to fall for the law enforcement officials? How often would they fall to the ground? Are there any internal guidelines under what circumstances that they would have to fall to the ground? Because issue emergency alert in case of a fall down is quite interesting. So the man down function could be easily abused and quirky. As his deputy director, I know that his main position and my colleagues will be happy to explain that how do we strike a balance. So while maintaining a clean streetscape and taking care of the disadvantaged, the HD frontline colleagues meet these challenges almost every day. So we could only do better on this front. So Dr. Xu is concerned about the issue of falling down. So the while on duties, they do face a lot of risk and challenges, and they need to discharge their duties, and they got work to do. Nobody wished to fall down. Though they are probably rare occurrences, but it's happened, it could be serious. That would lead to injuries and so on. So when planning for the system, we take reference with other system what technology is available. This is one function. Deputy Director, do you have any guidelines to teach the staff that in under what circumstances that you should fall right away? Our guidelines will be to prevent any falls. So the personal safety is always be careful. Should not injure themselves. That's been cleared. So there are discharging official duties in a legal basis. We'll not encourage and tell them when they can fall down. Of course not this way. We have given them a sufficient training to discharge the duties. And under this reasonable training, this has happened before, that a colleague is injured or have fell to the ground, that it shows that the incident is serious. That if the management is not alerted right away, that means we still got some way to go. So my question is next. So members' concern is not ill-founded. We understand that a man-down function has a necessity because during a duty, then there will be confrontation with the hawkers. And a few years ago, a South Asian had pushed a ABHD stuff to the ground and led to his death. And this function play is effective, we can't tell. So every time you show us that the money can actually solve these problems. For the system replacement, not that I don't disagree. I hope that the government, the way it's spending money or arrive at the cost estimate, can think of the long-term interest of Hong Kong people, make sure the money is well spent. So members have raised that whether can you be encrypted as the police or the FSD. Sometimes, and for some departments have already have a relative system, if you can coordinate with this department to use the base stations and so on, to the maintenance cost can be reduced. I don't know for the government, besides the FSD, ABHD, and the police, other departments have a similar communication system that's territory-wide. So do they use a different service providers? So that would not be effective use of public sources. So you can't say that all bureaus can coordinate the work, but of course, the departments under FHB, they should be coordinated to save money and spend at the right places. So I agree with this funding proposal. Members, any other questions? So no objections. So I will approve this to be submitted to the Finance Committee. Last item, AOB. There will be no other business meeting adjourned. Thank you.